Welcome to our Episcopal School Sunday service. Today we have students from Calvary Episcopal Preparatory participating in the service. They will lead and they will sing for us today. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Sarah Kalina. I am the Bible teacher of pre-K all the way through 12th grade for Calvary Episcopal School. I'm happy to be here with you today, and I hope you have a fabulous day.
Thank you.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it.
He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem, and now people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard.
What more was there to do for my vineyard than I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it waste, and it shall be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah in his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us read a portion of Psalm 80 responsively by whole verse. Restore us, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
You have brought the vine out of Egypt. You've cast out the nations and planted it.
You prepared the ground for it. It took root and filled the land.
The mountains were covered by its shadow, and the towering cedar trees by its boughs.
You stretched out its tendrils to the sea and its branches to the river.
Why have you broken down its wall so that all who pass by pluck its grapes?
The wild boar of the forest has ravaged it, and the beasts of the field have grazed upon it.
Turn now, O God of hosts, look down from heaven, behold and tend this vine. Preserve what your right hand has planted.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings, my becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on to the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord, Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew 21, verses 33 through 46. Jesus said, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect the produce. But the tenants seized his slaves, beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance. So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and they killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, he will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at harvest time. Jesus said to them, have you never read the scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to people that produce the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken into pieces, and it will crush anyone whom it falls. When the chiefs and priests and the Pharisees heard this parable, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The Gospel of the Lord. Good morning. My name's Beth Dow, and I'm the headmaster at Calvary Episcopal, and I was so excited to be asked to come today to talk about the Word of the Lord. When I read the scripture, I was reflecting upon my time as a child. I grew up on a ranch, and I had a father that I was extremely close to. I would bother him with all kinds of things, and he'd be very patient with me. I watched him in his time build many things. I saw him build fence, I saw him build sheds, I saw him work on tractors. And every time he did this, he did it with such precision and pride in putting forth a hard day's work. But I had never seen him work as hard as the day that he was going to build a stone horse barn. He loved his horses. He wanted to have pride in it. He wanted it to be strong for them. And he wanted it to be a work of art. So each stone was fit perfectly into place, like a puzzle piece. One corner of the building at the very base of this foundation, he set a stone, and it was a cornerstone. As a child, I had never heard the word cornerstone before, and I said, Daddy, what's a cornerstone? And he, very patiently, as he always was with me, he took my hand, he went under a tree, and he sat on a tin can. He wiped his brow from the heat being hot, and he looked at me and he said, baby girl, that stone right there is the first and most important stone in this structure. All the stones in this foundation are set in reference to this stone. This means that the cornerstone determines the position of this entire structure. For this building to be sound and to be here for many generations, for my grandbabies and my great-grandbabies, all these stones must line up. The other stones can be different sizes, different shapes. That doesn't matter. What is most important, that this cornerstone is strong, it's square, and it is perfect. It does not have any imperfections in it, because this whole building is resting on this stone, and everything has to be in alignment. And then he looked at me, he said, just as I am your cornerstone, your life and your history will be built on me, and it will be strong. After that day, I never forgot what a cornerstone meant. And whenever I hear that phrase, it brings back special memories of a very special time in my life. So it was very interesting that that was a scripture that I was going to get to read today, to take a closer look at the proverb that Jesus uses as a punchline for his parable. The stone that the builder rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing and is amazing in our eyes. This quotation says explicitly and dramatically what the parable intends. The religious leaders have rejected the Son of God. But this rejection will be reversed by God, and the leaders will lose their role in God's purpose. So what does this parable mean for us? I think we need to ask, how will we respond to the claims God has on our lives? Will we align ourselves with the cornerstone, or will we reject Christ in favor of our own desires as the wicked tenants did? Can we give God our all in response to his limitless grace that he's offered? I think the answer lies in our alignment with God's cornerstone. How do we stay in alignment? Do we always fall back on the answers, oh, I go to church, I pray, I'm good to my fellow man? Those are all very good answers. These are all good answers, and these activities are certainly a part of staying aligned with God's will. But maybe more important, it requires intentionality on our part. We must desire to be in God's will, and we need to make a conscious effort to align our cornerstone with Jesus Christ. God will always seek those who are willing to live in the right relationship with him. That relationship depends on our relationship with Jesus Christ. If we align ourselves with Christ, the cornerstone, we will be in the right relation with God the Father. As my daddy said, if we have alignment with his cornerstone, the structure will last for generations. Amen.
Holding on to you in the middle of the storm. I am holding.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through Jesus Christ our Lord. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Let us say together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
For the prayers of the people today are adapted from Form 6 in our Book of Common Prayer. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for this community, the nation, and the world,
for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace,
for the just and proper use of your creation,
for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression,
for all those who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, we pray especially for the men and women of our armed forces at home and abroad, that they may have a sense of your abiding presence wherever they may be.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Andy, Jeff, Kai, and Hector, our bishops, and the people of Calvary Church.
For all who serve God and his church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. We pray for those who are ill, and those we now name silently or aloud. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. We especially pray for Aggie Kendrick and those we now name silently or loud. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.